name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
In the waters of baptism, my mom died with Christ and rose with him to new life. May she now share with him the eternal glory. When Helene was a child, an infant, she was baptized. And that baptism, they gave her a white garment, which was a sign of her Christian dignity. As she was baptized into Christ, she was also baptized not only into his life, his death, and resurrection. Now, we once again are reminded of that promise of baptism, as once again God the casket with a white garment covered upon. Let us pray. O God of our ancestors in faith, by the covenant made on Mount Sinai, you taught your people to strengthen the bonds of family through faith, honor, and love. Look kindly upon Helene, our mother, who sought to bind her children to you. Bring her one day to our heavenly home, where the saints dwell in blessedness and peace. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
I invite you now to please be seated as we now listen to our first reading, which will be offered by Marlene, my sister.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will provide for all his people. On this mountain, he will destroy the veil that veils all peoples. The web that is woven over all nations, he will destroy death forever. The Lord God will wipe away the tears from all faces. The reproach of his people he will remove from the whole earth, for the Lord has spoken. On that day it will be said, "Behold our God, to whom we look to save us. This is the Lord for whom we looked. Let us rejoice and be glad that he has saved us." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Thank you.
God is my shepherd, so nothing shall I want. Rest in the meadows of faithfulness and love. My heart, my unquiet waters. Shepherd, beyond my you embrace me and feel my future soul. Be my pathways of righteousness and my spirit shall sing your music.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, are you unaware that we who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were indeed buried with him through baptism into death, so that, just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might live in newness of life. For if we have grown into union with him through a death like his, we shall also be united with him in the resurrection. We know that our old self was crucified with him, so that our sinful body might be done away with, that we might no longer be in slavery to sin. For a dead person has been absolved from sin. If, then, we have died in Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him. We know that Christ, raised from the dead, dies no more. Death no longer has power over him. The word of the Lord.
Reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. When Jesus arrived in Bethany, he found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Now Bethany was near Jerusalem, only about 2 miles away. Many of the Jews had come to Martha and Mary to comfort them about their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went to meet him, but Mary stayed at home. Martha said to Jesus, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now I know that whatever you ask of God, God will give you." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise." Martha said to him, "I know he will rise in the resurrection on the last day." Jesus told her, "I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, even if he dies, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this?" She said to him, "Yes, Lord. I have come to believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, the one who is coming into the world." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
My dear friends, before my homily, I want to offer a welcome to Your Excellency Archbishop Sample in our midst, and of course, Archbishop Vlazny, or I like to call him Arch Grandpa Vlazny. And of course, I want to thank my brothers who have been so supportive. And our families received so many emails and texts at the passing of our mom. I want to recognize Father John Kerns, who has been a mentor for me since I was a high schooler, and my dad told him regarding my possible vocation, "Go get him, Tiger." So yes, mission accomplished. Also, I want to thank Father Michael Johnston, the pastor here at St. Philip, because of his kindness. I asked him if he wouldn't mind just keeping me standing straight. I've done lots of funerals, but I've never done a funeral for my own mom. So we'll see how this goes. Father Mike Walker here is not a classmate, but he was a year ahead of me in seminary, and we met there. And as compadres, you might say, we've been journeying in our ministry, although separated in space, kind of in heart and mind, encouraging each other. And of course, his parents are here somewhere. The semi-adopted Walker family over there. And of course, Father Todd Molinari, he's the vicar of clergy. He's kind of the one that makes sure that we priests are doing what we're supposed to be doing. So I want to let you know, Archbishop Sample, that Father Todd has been very helpful to me and also keeping me on the straight and narrow. So it's all good. Well, today is a day of hope and faith. It is a time to be mindful of how God's grace has been poured upon us. It's also a time to mourn and to grieve and to pray. These aren't bad things. In fact, these are good things. I would like to offer this idea for us to ponder, that in this moment that we gather, it is precious time. Maybe we might even see it as a time of sobriety amidst the distractions of our daily lives, our routines and our worries. More contemporary descriptions might be woke or enlightened. But it only comes through suffering. It comes especially through death. We may know people that are distant from us that die, and we may feel bad for them, but the closer home it gets, the harder it is, and it wrenches our hearts open more. So anyway we describe this experience, I'd like to call it precious time. And I bless this time, even though I did not and I do not invite it, it comes upon me and us. All of us have our own worries and concerns, and I assume they're all valid. I know I get focused on these things when, as a pastor, I'm pressed on this or that of administration. But ultimately, those are not as important as times like this. It's not as important to be praying for our loved ones and being at the bedside of our own parents, especially when they pass. These are times to be focused, to allow the pain to transform us. This is what we call the Paschal mystery in theological terms, the suffering and death of Jesus led to his resurrection. And we are called to walk the same path, to pick up our cross, to suffer with him and with others, to die to ourselves so that we may live again and see differently. So I can only imagine, though, what it is like for bishops, though, because their worries is way beyond us little pastors. So I'm just glad you're able to get away and share in this precious time. Today's reading from Isaiah reminds me of how veiled so many things are and how this precious time rips it open, not in a bad way, but in a good way. We have the grace of God, and our Heavenly Father wants to shower us with his grace of love, compassion, and mercy. In our family this past week, it's interesting to get all those Holtzingers together. Today is going to be more because my brother Michael here, he's a minister up in Everett, Washington. I think that'll be everyone now, other than our brother Gregory. But to get us all together is a feat in of itself. We come for weddings. We came for Mom and Jerry's wedding here. And we come for funerals. Remember today, we remember Patty. And other family members that are extended. But see, we hear from Isaiah that the veil that veils us is pulled away, destroyed, that veil being death. And by that, our tears will be wiped away. And we will no longer be distant from God, but close to God and to each other. See, such a divine act is something that we can't do on our own, but we experience through God's grace, through his actions. And he wants to bring us to himself, to heaven, to be transformed away from the distractions that aren't important, to become who we have been always called to be like God while still being human beings here on earth, to be the humans he wants us to be, as it was in the beginning. And so in this vision, or this sober vision of reality, the scriptures are clear. It is through baptism into the death of Jesus that we can come to eternal life. And many of us were baptized as infants or as youth, or maybe adults. Jesus, or Paul, reminds us that if we die with Christ, we will live with him. This means we need to stay close to our Lord if we are to maintain communion with him unto death. About 14 months ago, my brother-in-law Lance, who's here with my sister Carolyn, introduced my mom to a novena called the Surrender Novena. I don't know if you've heard of it. You can Google it. For those of you unfamiliar with the concept of a novena, it's basically a set of prayers that are offered one time for 9 days, so a total of 9 prayers. So Mom started this novena and prayed it with an open heart. It really touched her deeply. And after completing the 9 days, she decided to do it again. And then again. And again. In the last estimation, talking to her, she has offered the novena over 30 times. The core of the prayer has a refrain, which I think would be helpful for us all to hear. I know it is for me, especially in a time like now. Oh Jesus, I surrender myself to you. Take care of everything. Oh Jesus, I surrender myself to you. Take care of everything. So for over a year, Mom has been surrendering herself into the arms and the will of Jesus. Again, think about how much we all worry about things. With the unrest in our country, throughout the world, the coronavirus. We might be tempted to obsess with worry. I mean, if you watch the TV news, you will likely be drawn right into it. Yet our Lord has shared over and over in the scriptures, do not be afraid. Do not worry about tomorrow. Tomorrow's worries are for itself. And at the end of the day of the novena, the person is invited to repeat this 10 times, just to emphasize it in their heart, to let it steep like a tea bag in hot water. Oh Jesus, I surrender myself to you. Take care of everything. And by surrendering our worries, we are given over to God. And by letting go, we live out the command Jesus taught us in the Our Father, where we hear and say, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. When we are in need, do we turn to Jesus? Or do we turn solely to our own devices or the way we want things to be? What we need to do is to surrender to Jesus. Do you see evil growing instead of weakening? Don't worry. Surrender to Jesus. He can take care of everything. Are you sleepless, wanting to judge everything and see everything, surrendering to human strength only? Don't worry. Let Jesus take care of it. Surrender to God. Ponder and say from your heart, oh Jesus, I surrender myself to you. Take care of everything. Well, Mom said this so many times. I guess it's no wonder why she, when it came to the end, she died rather quickly. Either that or she just wanted that last glass of wine and we weren't going to give it to her. She would like to drink her wine. And once she was told she couldn't have 2 glasses, but only one, according to the nurse, Marianne made that clear. Mom said, fine, and then didn't drink it. And then she passed within 24 hours, or less, actually. So we like that part of the story, but I think it also reminded her we can't get everything we want in this world. There's something better beyond. So I imagine, because I cannot read her heart, but knowing Mom, I think she was prepared to surrender herself to her Savior, trusting with her whole self that Jesus would take care of everything, and trusting herself and us, her family, to God. In the Gospel of Luke, we heard this kind of trust from Martha. Think of this. This is Martha, who loves Lazarus so much. We can imagine her crying and her weeping and wailing, maybe even angry at Jesus because he waited. But despite her grief or whatever anger she may have had, she trusted Jesus to save her brother Lazarus. Mom did too. She trusted our Lord with everything. And through that, through time, suffering, joy, letting go, and finally dying into the merciful love of Christ, we are invited to do the same in our hearts for her. I often invite congregations at funerals to ponder on the good things of the deceased and let the example inspire them to do similarly, to live like them. Today I can say that we sons and daughters of Helene are doing that now. We have chosen a path, each of us, in big and small ways. Each of us have decided to give ourselves away, whether it be a parent or a priest, a teacher, whatever it might be. Mom saw this in every one of us, and it made her very happy. These last several nights, I've been putting myself to bed, listening to her. And she's so proud of us. She's delighted in having 9 kids. She used to get mocked for having just 4 in tow. All of us have chosen the path of service. All of us have responded. Marlene, you're a nurse. Michael, you're a minister. Judith, you were an administrator and a signer for the deaf and a teacher. Marianne, you should have gotten hazard pay for teaching in the LA school district, South Central LA. Kathy, you were a principal at a Catholic grade school, the Cathedral School in Boise, and you just retired out of another public school, giving of yourself to teachers and children. And Carolyn, as a speech pathologist, you've been helping those who are struggling in all kinds of ways be able to express themselves. And Anne, you've been a math teacher and a mom, and you have some awesome kids, that's for sure. I'm glad to see them all here. Mom suffered, probably because of some of us and our activities, I'm sure. But one of the things she taught us to be was to be independent. And I think she regrets that because we're so independent. But at the same time, that's the image of who she was. Mom was that sort of person that did not allow some particular barriers to get in her way. She was strong in her faith, and she put her time and talent where her heart was. Her pro-life advocacy compelled her to work directly with women who were newly pregnant and were contemplating abortion. She became a spiritual director of sorts to many women. She led prayer services and took communion to the sick, including your own beloved late husband, Jerry. She served as a founding member of the Catholic Daughters in Medford, where she lived with most of us when we were growing up. She participated in Bible studies here. That's where she met Jerry. That's a pretty good place to meet another person. She attended Mass whenever she could. Her jobs were always involved in service of others. She even served as a security guard, if you can imagine that. I'm sure she was very intimidating. When she and Jerry started courting, her faith was the most important thing, and she made that very clear. They were like teenagers, however, so it was quite fun to watch them. I remember Mom asking me, "Jerry got me some flowers, some yellow flowers. What does that mean?" I'm like, "Really, Mom, you're asking me?" They worshiped together here at St. Philip as a couple. They sat right over there. They prayed together. They laughed together. And whenever there was an argument, one of them would say, "I just love you." And Jerry especially would just lose it. And so with my mom, she's also Irish. So getting married in their 80s, you would think, well, that won't last very long. Who would have thunk 11 years later, finally Jerry would pass. And now we're here today, sending off Mom. And there's just so much we could say about Mom, but there's no time. But among them all, it's her faith that drove her and guided her. Jesus was and is her shepherd in life and now in death. And because of that, we have a faith-filled hope. Let us not mistake this time. It is precious time. Even though we have sadness, do not let it become despair. The tears we cry or the sadness we feel inside is piercing a veil, a darkness, so that we might be able to see what is not normally seen or feel what is maybe not always felt, to let go of those things that are not important and focus on the things that are the most important. From this event in our lives, the veil has been torn and given us a glimpse from our side to the other. I hope for each of us there's some clarity. I hope that we, when we're done here, will recheck how busy we are and unclutter. That's been tough for us as we're trying to unclutter the house. May we therefore surrender ourselves, like Mom did, into the loving arms of Jesus. He's got this. He can take care of everything. And so thank you, Mom, for your example of faith, hope, and love. May we honor you in living our lives as you did. May when we leave here, entrust ourselves to the Good Shepherd, the Shepherd of our souls, and fear not, and have no worries. O Jesus, we surrender ourselves to you. Take care of everything. Please stand now for our prayers of faith. I invite you to call them forth. God, the Almighty Father, raised Christ, his Son, from the dead. With confidence, we ask you to save all his people, living and dead.
For Helene, who in baptism was given the pledge of eternal life, that she may now be admitted to the company of the saints, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our sister who ate the body of Christ, the bread of life, that she may be raised up on the last day, we pray to the Lord.
Lord,
for the family and friends of our sister Helene, that they may be consoled in their grief by the Lord, who wept at the death of his friend Lazarus, we pray to the Lord.
Lord,
for all of us assembled here to worship in faith, that we may be gathered together again in God's kingdom, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
God, our shelter and our strength, You listen in love to the cry of your people. Hear the prayers we offer for our departed brothers and sisters, especially mom. Cleanse them all of their sins and grant them the fullness of redemption through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Right now, please be seated. Carry the altar. Pray, my brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept sacrifice in your hands, and who praise the glory of his name, for our healing and all his holy church.
Look with favor, O Lord, upon your servant Helene, whom we offer you the sacrifice of praise, humbly entreated that, reconciled with you through these devoted offices, she may merit to rise again to life, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. In him, the hope of blessed resurrection is dawned, that those saddened by the certainty of dying might be consoled by the promise of immortality to come. Indeed, for your faithful Lord, life is changed, not ended. And when this earthly dwelling turns to dust, an eternal dwelling is made ready for them in heaven. And so, with the angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim.
Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory.
Please kneel for this. If you are watching online, we will be offering Eucharistic prayer number 3, which has a prayer specifically for the deceased. You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, Lord, we humbly implore you by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. From the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of a new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Therefore, Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim, by his death that you willed to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ.
May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with Saint Philip and all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help.
May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth with your servant Francis, our Pope, Alexander, our Bishop, Peter, his auxiliary bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own.
Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. Remember your servant Helene, whom you have called from this world to yourself. Grant that she who is united with your Son in a death like his may also be one with him in his resurrection, when from the earth he will rise up in the flesh those who have died and transform our lowly body after the pattern of his own glorious body. And to our departed brothers and sisters too, and to all who are passing, and all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, when you will wipe away every tear from our eyes. For seeing you, our God, as you are, we shall be like you for all the ages, and praise you without end, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow in the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever. At the Savior's command, and formed by divine teaching, we now dare to say, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we wait the blessed hope in the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant your peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord,
I am not worthy that you should enter into my room, but only
say your word, and my soul shall be
Renewed by this life-giving sacrament, we pray, O Lord, that the soul of our mother, Helene, to whom you gave a part in your covenant, may be purified by the power of this mystery and rejoice without end in the peace of Christ, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
Normally there's announcements. Again, I want to thank you. That'd be wonderful.
Is it worth?
Yes, we need.
have to ask his permission to say a word.
Have a word. Should we have a
video? Maybe for the, I don't know, the video streaming people.
Yeah, I can see. Easy.
No. Don't worry, it's not going to be another homily. No, I just, as the Archbishop, I just wanted to say a word to you, Father Bill, our brother, and to all of your family. I just want to express on behalf of all of the priests, the deacons, the religious, and the lay faithful of the Archdiocese of Portland, our sincere and profound sympathies to all of you on the passing of your mom. You know, I sorry guys, you know, they hear this at all the funerals, but you're hearing it for the first time maybe. You know, when a priest, he's very blessed to have kind of three families. There's the family he grows up with, and then when he becomes a priest, he becomes part of another family. He becomes part of this fraternity, this brotherhood that we share among ourselves as priests. And then he has his parish family that he draws very close to. And so I know this is a stretch of logic, but because Father Bill is part of our family in the priesthood here in this archdiocese, you're all part of our family too. And we feel your loss very deeply. But as Father Bill so beautifully said, you know, we place your mom in the hands of our Lord now. And I like that, you know, he's got this. And just remember that we're only separated for a time and that, you know, we'll all see Helene one day in the kingdom. And one little bit of piece of information I didn't know, your mom and I had something else very much in common, the whole wine thing. My mother was always, you know, she was, especially she got older and she had medication, she was always limited to two glasses. And there was a place on the glass that I made sure it didn't go beyond that. But she was always pushing for number three. So we had to control her too. So they're probably, where's your mom's favorite wine?
Port.
Mom's was Chardonnay. Well, anyway, they're toasting up in heaven, I'm sure now. But anyway, Father Bill, our deepest sympathies to you. Just know that you're all supported, Father Bill. You're all supported by our love and our prayers and our support in this time. And may God usher her quickly into the glorious kingdom of heaven. God bless you.
Commonly, there is after a mass, there's a reception. Unfortunately, because of COVID-19, there is no reception. So in honor of my mom, I might encourage you to go to the grocery outlet. Go to the Basilica of St. Costco. You can go to the Ram or the, what was it, Washington Street Grill. Those are all your options. If you want to honor my mom in your own way or a way of celebrating her life, we as a new to her family and extended family will be at our house with our masks doing what we're supposed to do and be one these days. But nonetheless, I want to thank also my sisters and my brother for being here. Especially Michael, you've driven a long ways, and Megan has probably got some long distance award from all the way to the East Coast, so that's a big deal. And I've been, my reason, you've never heard of two archbishops at a mass. I've never heard of it either. So, Mom, you must be awesome. You guys see some of the pictures of her when she was younger. She was also a hottie. A lot of boyfriends, which well, some of them are in those pictures. So. Yes. Let us stand now. Trusting in God, we have prayed together for my mom. And now we come to the last farewell. There is sadness in parting, but we take comfort in the hope that one day we will see Helene again and enjoy her friendship. Although we will disperse in sorrow, the mercy of God will gather us together again in the joy of his kingdom. Therefore, let us console one another in the faith of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Into your hands, Father of Mercies, we commend our sister Helene, our mom, in the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, she will rise with him on the last day. We give you thanks for the blessings which you bestowed upon our mom in this life. They are signs to us of your goodness and of our fellowship with the saints in Christ. Merciful Lord, turn toward us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servant and help us who remain to comfort one another with the assurances of faith until we all meet in Christ and are with you and our mother forever. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Normally, we end with a statement of taking the deceased to their place of rest. After this celebration, the funeral, she'll be cremated, and the family will have a private burial at Mount Calvary Catholic Cemetery in Portland. And so we will end as we normally do. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Now go in peace.
Thanks be to God. Thank you.